So in this presentation, we're going to focus on some of the new developments, but we'll try to leave enough time that if you want to talk about some of our other specific optical sensors or issues either that you have or questions that you have or questions where you think some of the other instruments might address some of the things that I'm bringing up here, we'll make time for that. So let's see. Okay. So what I'm going to go over today is first, not knowing exactly the level of comfort with respect to all things optics, I'll spend a little time laying a little bit of groundwork at just a really basic level, and I'm going to focus on it just from a color point of view, because frankly, that's what got me interested in ocean optics. I was just very interested in not just working with numbers, but working with things that I could see, or at least things that instruments could see, and color was very interesting to me. Oceanography is actually a second career for me, and my last job in a previous career, I worked for Technicolor Film Services, the movie production company, and I worked with color there. So it was sort of a natural progression to work from a two-dimensional piece of acetate with things that absorb light and scatter light to give you an image to going to the ocean where we have this three-dimensional medium with things that happen to, again, absorb and scatter light and are really quite beautiful, whether you're looking at it from the point of view of, let's say, a satellite or imagery, or from the point of view of just understanding the biology and sort of what you can see, which you can't really see without a microscope. So I think that that's, and then we'll talk about some of the innovations that we wanted to present today, a dual wavelength chlorophyll fluorometer, our ACS product, which is an absorption and attenuation meter that's hyperspectral, and kind of where we're going with hyperspectral radiometry, essentially sensing light from the ocean in support of the next generation remote sensing satellites, which is planned for the NASA PACE satellite is set for launch early next year. So we're doing some instrument development in support of that, which will essentially give you a hint of what's to come for our customers. So let's just take a look at color for a moment. And what we see just out in the plant world, and of course the ocean is 70% of the Earth's surface, plants grow in that, they're microscopic. We don't see them quite as leaves, but we've all experienced, you know, an algal bloom somewhere, either in a lake, a river, or in the ocean. And it has color. But what we can see here is just a single leaf. And in this particular case, it's a single leaf over sort of the life cycle from spring to fall. And what's interesting about this is we think of, okay, a leaf has chlorophyll in it. Chlorophyll is green. And so the first one fits our expectations. And we know that leaves turn supposedly a different color. What that is it's really a hidden color. There's so much chlorophyll that you don't see all these other colors during the year. Sometimes you do, but we don't see most of the other colors. And it's when the chlorophyll pigment actually degrades, that's when we see the other colors. And why are those other colors there? We'll see this kind of from a spectral point of view, from a graph, but I wanted you just to experience it just in a color point of view. These are all the pigments, these yellow, red pigments that were there in the first place to help capture more of the sunlight. If chlorophyll is green, it's absorbing mostly in the blue and in the red. So that's why you see green, because you're seeing the light reflected that isn't absorbed. So it's a kind of a subtractive process. But you can see that the leaf, in addition to just absorbing in the green, you know, there's some yellow and different color reds in there. So this is trying to give you sort of a qualitative understanding that we're not just talking about chlorophyll in terms of what's on the frontier of optics. We're trying to understand really what makes up the planet with respect to the biology. And by the way, I will focus a lot on biology, but if you were taking a look at a river plume, it's really the same situation. Now, this isn't life in this case. The Fraser River outflow into Georgia Strait off of Vancouver, British Columbia. It's a big river plume. It's one that I've studied. There's probably phytoplankton in the water, but what there is a lot of sediment. And that sediment also, as we know, has absorption colors. It has its own spectrum. And all the dynamics with respect to the equipment that we have, you can pretty much translated over into a mineralogenic or a mixed biologic mineralogenic environment. So if I happen to focus on biology and your interest is more in, let's say, sedimentary processes like river plumes or water quality issues with suspended sediments, it all applies, and you can call me out on it later or ask questions if there's specific questions you have about that. So now let's just look at this same picture now from the way that an optical oceanographer would look at it. And we're really just looking at it in an absorption spectrum. What, when the photons hit the surface of the leaf, or in this case, maybe the outside of a phytoplankton, what light is absorbed? And obviously chlorophyll exists to be the start of photosynthesis. It's a photosynthetic pigment. It's what drives, you know, the every what other breath that you take of oxygen comes from the ocean as a result of photosynthesis. So that green curve represents chlorophyll A, and there's another in some plants as well as algae is chlorophyll B. And we can see that it absorbs in the really almost over in the blue and violet region, and it also absorbs in the red. And actually internally, what happens to these blue and violet photons, they get absorbed and they sort of end up trickling over. They get sort of re-emitted internally. It's not quite an emission process, but it kind of bounces over in the energy levels over to here. So this is the big one. But what we see is a lot is green because it doesn't absorb here. It's absorbing the red light and absorbing the blue and violet light. But what we also see in, if we looked at the complement of pigments, and I'm just going to pick one general class of these carotenoids, these are non-photosynthetic pigments in the sense that they don't directly drive photosynthesis, but they help capture more photons. You can think of it as enlarging your antenna array. If you were thinking of it in terms of radio, you'd add additional antennas. And in fact, they're called antenna structures in photosynthesis. So they're essentially, another way to think of it is trampolines that are linked together. So you have these photons that bounce onto these blue and maybe cyan colored trampolines, and then they bounce over to typically the red one, a lower energy one, and become part of photosynthesis. So it's the idea to capture more light. And that's why the color of phytoplankton is a little bit different. It evolves according to sometimes the niches that those different phytoplankton inhabit. So what we want to do is not just look at chlorophyll, which is a really good, well, it's one of the best proxies we have for biomass. It's not actually a very good proxy because it's very physiologically variable, but it's one that's easy to sense, and obviously it's used widely to get at least a first order idea of biomass. But if we're interested in understanding who makes up the community, which is really where the frontier of ocean science is, we want to look at these other pigments. So how does that happen? So one thing that we know just from childhood is we take a mess of colors and mix them together, we get a new color. And so that's kind of the point of that very first leaf photo. And what these are actually just extracts of different individual phytoplankton pigments. Their color's slightly modified because they've used a solvent as opposed to water. But you get the idea that, in fact, if we took various portions of these and mixed them together along with the green of chlorophyll, we could get a whole variety and range of colors. And if we saw that in terms of that absorption spectrum, we would see different shapes for different things. And this is what happens in nature. So this is just a microphotograph of cyanobacteria. So the individual elements are actually quite small. These are strands of filamentous bacteria. So in general, bacteria are really hard to image optically because they're so small. We've got a single diatom here, and you can see they're very different colors, but they're both photosynthetic organisms. So they're both green. They both have a green pigment, but that's not what they look like. So if they don't look like that to you, they're not going to look like that to either our ACS thing or an ocean color satellite or our radiometers. We're going to see that same color, albeit in a different way, in that spectral way. And so that's kind of what we want to do, is try to understand that as really a cyanobacteria. And let's take a look at those spectra here. So the cyanobacteria are a little bit cyan, in other words, this color, because we have the chlorophyll, but you can see right here in this kind of blue region, we're not absorbing much light. They don't have these carotenoids. They have phycocyanin. Conversely, that brown diatom, it's called a brown, it's a brown algae, it's one of the major lineages of algae. It has those carotenoids, it's a diatom. It looks brown because we are now absorbing in this cyan region, and the, take that messy color picture again, mix the right paints together, you get brown. So what we're really after is trying to understand more about the biological makeup. And again, you can transfer this on to mineralogenic environments too. If you had a yellow clay and a red clay or whatever the sedimentary processes that were being delivered by a river or some other process that's suspending sediment in the water, that would help you understand because it could be, let's say, a mixture coming from two different sources. And we'll talk about that mixture idea in a minute. So if we have a single channel color sensor, it's kind of like having one color crayon. We pick the color that makes sense to us for a particular observation. Some of our instruments have started off with a color, one color that makes sense. So our beam transmissometer, it's a C-star if you've used it, but it's a U-shaped thing. And all it is it's a beam of light that goes from, you know, it's collimated, so it makes a straight path from a lens to a receiver. And you're really just trying to understand how many photons make it. The only photons that don't make it are ones that are either absorbed or they're scattered out of the light beam. I've been talking about absorption, but scattering is yet another process. But the purpose of that instrument is to understand how many photons don't make it there. We think of it in terms of, let's say, percent transmission. But what gives us the information is are the photons that didn't make it. And even just one single color, 660 nanometers, so essentially when you look at it, it's safe to look at the LED and that instrument, it's red. And that's for a short, meaning 10 to 25 centimeter path length, that's a good choice for ease of use in terms of the LEDs that we can acquire and the water process, the water absorption itself. So that turns out if you do take that C-star, put it on CTDs all over the globe and start making measurements, which is exactly what's happened, it has a very nice correlation to the concentration of particulate organic carbon. And in the era of climate change where carbon is our currency, that's really what we want. We've got a budget and we have line items and we have uncertainties on each one of those line items. Particulate organic carbon, just from one wavelength of a single measurement, the key was these are on these CTDs everywhere. So the next time you happen to be on a ship, take a look, ask to see the transmissometer, take a look at it, or take a look at it in our catalog, but you'll see the power of essentially having lots of those instruments around in terms of even just a single wavelength. Then we could go to the Crayola, whatever, 6 or 7 pack. And when now we get some points, and it starts to look like that chlorophyll absorption curve or the phytoplankton absorption curve, you can sort of draw a line in between there. You could use your, sort of interpolation routine from Excel or your favorite program and begin to sort of fill in between the dots. But what we just saw is some of those curves that we saw for those accessory pigments, the carotenoids, that brown color, or the phycocyan with the blue color, there's some interesting little wiggles in there that you don't get. That said, that's really been the state of ocean color from remote sensing since the first satellite in the 80s, CZCS. Coastal zone color scanner, but we had CWIFs and MODIS, and now we have VIRS and Sentinel from the European Space Agency. And they're pretty much giving us the entire view of the world with ocean products derived usually from 3 or 4, not even 7 colors. Some of the other colors are often used for atmosphere correction and trying to get that actual signal of what the light that's leaving the water is right, since we're out in space and we have all that atmosphere to go through, which some people are interested in, but oceanographers want that stuff to go away. So it's a natural progression to go to the Crayola 72 or 144 or 288 pack. And you can imagine, even as an artist, if I gave you all of those, you can do more interesting things with, you know, nuances in the pictures that we draw, the colors that we use, and the maybe waxing a little bit romantic, but the sentiment. Well, the sentiment in biological oceanography, or likewise for, again, mineral, logic process is really to understand that community. So that's the sentiment. So now, with that many colors, we don't just have the dots. We have all of these like little wiggles right there, shoulders and peaks, and those mean something. That's information. So if you happen to have had, let's say, a background in electrical engineering or studied communications thing, you can look at this as an information theory process. You know, the more information we have, essentially the more we can understand, or it's essentially the more we can understand about what's being communicated. So this slide probably should have popped back a little bit, but we're able to get these global estimates of essentially chlorophyll, which is a proxy, imperfect proxy for phytoplankton biomass, from just really a few colors in that thing. So has anybody here worked with remote sensing data, you know, and or the products? So some of us work kind of directly on the, let's say, the reflectances, the actual colors, and some of us will download the subsequent products that have been derived for them. And but what you can see is, you know, some of the things that we expect. In coastal environments, we see a lot more phytoplankton than we see out in the open ocean. And there are whole regions that, for example, right here, that are very low, and that's got a name. It's called the HNLC, or high nutrient, low chlorophyll environments of the ocean. And you'd say, well, if I have lots of nutrients and I have light, don't I have everything I need to grow? Well, what if you lost an essential vitamin? That's what limits growth there. And that happens to be a super small micronutrient, nanonutrient, really, it's iron. It's an iron-limited region. You get dust storms in Africa, they blow all the way over here, and then you see phytoplankton blooms. And this has been confirmed by experiments where we literally dumped iron slurries into the ocean and essentially forced phytoplankton blooms. So we can confirm this. Some of the coastal region typically is overpredicted because there's some interference in the coast with land. But to the first order, this is the kind of thing that ocean color satellites give us. Of course, in local regions, you can do something as simple as one of my favorite papers when I was a graduate student was in Galway Bay, which would be somewhere up here, right? This was back in the early part of just after the millennium, took a Nikon Coolpix, and the Nikon Coolpix at the time was the only camera that you could turn off the exposure control, where it sort of messes with the colors. It just gave you RGB pixels. And they did essentially took the data, then took water samples, got the chlorophyll, looked at the dissolved organic material in there by filtering the water, and again, looking at the color of that water with a spectrophotometer, and created a regression. In other words, they plotted some points that basically says, here's the color of the pixels that I have, here are the amounts of chlorophyll or CDOM, colored dissolved organic material that I have. And they made their own, essentially, ocean color sensor out of a Nikon Coolpix. I mean, it's really that easy. And it's a reminder that simple things can be very, very powerful. It doesn't have to be a satellite. So when you think about when I've presented this in terms of, let's say, ground truthing or validating satellites, you could be, you know, ground truthing or validating a Nikon Coolpix, your own sensor. So it spans the gamut. And that's some of the reason for the instruments that we do have, is to help push that frontier, again, whether it's from space or essentially the end of a pier. So here's sort of the full Monty, if you want to call it that. I guess I'm in the UK, I can say that. These are, again, more of the pigments that we saw before, and this is what we get essentially when we have that Crayola 144 or 288 pack on the ACS, which is our absorption and scattering meter. We actually have 80 wavelengths that still qualifies as being hyperspectral, because you can fill in the dots here pretty nicely. So we talked about the cyanobacteria and the diatom, and they had different pigments, and that what we see and what our instruments see are different colors. So but what we see typically is the mixture of those colors, and what we'd like to do is unmix them. And if that information is relatively unique, and it's kind of a mathematical problem to determine whether there's a unique solution here, but let's wave our hands a little bit, and someone's smiling back there who has dealt with this. But let's call it for the moment a mostly, what we call a mostly, what I would call a mostly determined problem. We want to try to unmix. And I'll give you an example here. We have coffee and we add some milk and we add some more milk and we add some more milk. And as we know, first of all, when you first add it, it has a high concentration in a certain region. So think phytoplankton bloom in the ocean. And then we mix it and it gets mixed in a little bit more. So that could be either a local or a large scale mesoscale process that's doing that mixing. But nevertheless, but what we'd like to do is take the mixed cup of coffee and figure out how much milk was in there. So if we had the absorption spectrum for the milk and we had the absorption spectrum for the coffee, and that's really the only two constituents that we have, we want to take that full spectrum and say, I want a little bit, this fraction between 0 and 1 or 0 and 100% of the absorption of milk. Oops, that should be a plus, sorry about that. Plus 1 minus that fraction of coffee. So what we'd really like to do is have this picture and come out with this number. And so we just really have an equation where we know these absorption spectrums, we've got this. It's in this way I've posed it here, it's a fully determined problem I can solve for the fraction of milk. So you know where I'm going here. I'm going to try to find the fraction of some phytoplankton, right? Or something like that. But that's what we call spectral unmixing. There are other techniques that are similar to this or use different aspects of the absorption spectrum, but I thought this one was kind of interesting just because we could hang on to the notion of mixing. There are other ways that we can look at those curves, and for those of you who have calculus, we can take derivatives of those curves. So if you remember, like the first derivative gives you slope, the second derivative gives you whether it's a peak or a valley, and you can go on to third and fourth and fifth derivatives, which gets you into the voodoo of what's called spectral derivatives. But we can look for those little shoulders and try to figure out is it an up shoulder or a down shoulder and what happened before it and what happened after it. And so here's an example of some work done by a Brazilian ocean optics person. And she went out and just collected water samples and then filtered them through different filters and different size fractions. And we pretty much use the same notation as you do. So micro, nano, pico, no, sorry, it's a micro, sorry, micro, nano, pico, right? Not that order. And she settled on just the two endpoints, which is an often, you know, sort of trick of when you're looking at mix, take a look at the two endpoints, and that seemed to be it, and came up with essentially two absorption curves. And there's real, we'll talk about it, we can talk about it later, but there's real physical reasons why these two curves are different for micro and pico. They have to do with how the pigments are packaged and shade each other. But in general, the larger phytoplankton had, and I'm just normalized these by some, like the area under the curve, it's flatter in this region and a little bit, about the same peak here, but it's flatter, whereas this one is a little bit more peaked. So this is just like the milk. I've got the milk spectrum, I've got the coffee spectrum, and I've got the whole spectrum, and I want to figure out what's the fraction of small and what's the fraction of large. And that's actually very interesting. Just that single number is very interesting. If I follow that along a phytoplankton bloom, a lot of phytoplankton blooms out in the ocean start off with diatoms, large organisms, they're brown. They have this kind of flatter spectrum. Once that bloom has typically exhausted the nutrients or micronutrients, they become essentially a kind of a compost. Zooplankton eat some of them, their fecal pellets drop, we have carbon sequestration, but the community becomes very mixed. And there's a large, much larger fraction at that point of smaller phytoplankton, which by virtue of their size are actually more efficient at scavenging nutrients. So just following along this fraction, so we're just plotting one number, the fraction of large versus small phytoplankton versus time, is a single very interesting curve, just like plotting perhaps over time, you know, how much milk you put in your coffee. So we have instruments that start to now take a look at these different aspects of whether we start off with one wavelength, two wavelengths, many wavelengths, and I'll kind of go through now the same repetition of of wavelengths, going from single wavelengths to multiple wavelengths, and what we can learn from things in terms of our latest advances. So any questions so far? Have I kept everybody engaged here or on the same level? Good. So any questions? Okay, good.
There's a four letter up.
The purple area on the map. Or on the
map. Oh, this high nutrient, low chlorophyll region?
Yeah.
And so that's a persistent feature in the ocean. And you'll see that turn more blue or green after the passing of a dust storm from Africa. Is that what was your question?
Say the Mediterranean, for instance, if you had a dump of iron in the set, that could alter that chemistry dramatically and change the color spectrum. Is that right?
I'm sorry, I'm having a little problem hearing you. So if you could.
Is it my accent? Or just... did you mention that an introduction of iron would create
A bloom?
A bloom, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah, so it's a. As we know, even humans can develop conditions where we're missing a nutrient, right? Vitamin D, for example. We just add the nutrient in, things get better for life.
No, I'm just thinking of fish aquaculture, you know, that kind of thing, if you wanted to generate an area for fish aquaculture.
Oh, interesting, yeah. You know, that gets into what's actually in being discussed now with respect to climate change, which is geoengineering. If you take it, you know, a couple scales up, if I were able to take that whole region and suddenly start fertilizing it, would I grow more phytoplankton? And more importantly, when those phytoplankton grow, would they actually sequester carbon down to the deep? That's the big question. Plus, we're sort of mucking with a whole ecosystem, and it doesn't exist in isolation, so you can guess where I'm going with that. But you can think of that same issue in the small. If you had an area that was missing nutrients for whatever reason, you could fertilize it. The question is, does that make sense in terms of the intersection with other things around that process? So if I take a bioreactor, you know, an aquaculture where I'm using tanks, of course, you know, you are going to be adding nutrients. When we just even in the lab grow phytoplankton cultures just to study them, we use media that have a certain amount of nutrient. We even have names for them. And so, yeah, we have to supply all of those things. So if I was some of the experiments, for example, to derive essentially, you know, energy products from just growing phytoplankton in vats, of course, it's the same thing. And they might even use, in addition to a chlorophyll fluorometer, you might monitor the color. I mean, I'm not sure that would be the best example, but you certainly would add nutrients. Now, whether you want to introduce them intentionally into the environment, that's it's kind of a tricky question. So let's take a look at one sensor that maybe many of you are familiar with. It's called our environmental characterization optics. Not many people know that ECO, our ECO line of sensors, is actually an acronym, environmental characterization optics. And they're available with one, two, or three sensors, and maybe in the future, maybe one more, maybe. And the typical complement is either two, fluorescence and backscattering, or in the water quality world, where they like to call, instead of call it backscattering, we call it turbidity, but it's the same sensor, just calibrated in a different way. And then the third sensor that you'll see often applied is for colored dissolved organic material. Turns out that stuff fluoresces. If you shine an ultraviolet light on it, it fluoresces in the sort of blue-green region. So chlorophyll, if I shine roughly we'll get there. Oh, so one of the issues that we have with our chlorophyll fluorometers is how well does it represent the biomass of the world's oceans? And a little bit of a complicated graph, but take a look at the central one. And what we've done on the bottom is taken water samples, and we've extracted the pigments using a process called high-performance liquid chromatography. It's one of the gold standards, and this is, at least amongst optical oceanographers, this is the way we really know how much chlorophyll is in something. So when we want to do validate an ocean color algorithm for getting satellite ocean color, the gold standard we use are these HPLC measurements. So what we've done is essentially taken water samples, and we've taken an eco measurement and used our factory calibrated value, which was based on a monoculture of a single species, because we had to pick something, and we calibrated the fluorometer. How well does that match? And this is the one-to-one line, meaning if a dot falls along here, it's a matchup, a perfect matchup. And you can see that this is a logarithmic axis here, so there's a lot of scatter. There's sometimes even a factor of 10 between different regions of the world, between the Southern Ocean and up to the South Pacific Ocean. If you take a look at any one color, you can see, let's take a look at this kind of purple color. In general, except for here, we're kind of over-predicting the chlorophyll. There are other regions where we're doing well, and then up in the South Indian Ocean, we're way over-predicting. But there's scatter around this line. Again, if we look at this instead of a logarithmic axis on the chlorophyll, and we just look at this first region from about here on a linear axis, we can see some of the larger regions in this area. So what we'd like to do is do kind of collapse that a little bit. And we have some ideas about how to collapse that variability. And remember, this isn't a problem with the eco sensor. This is a problem that the amount of chlorophyll and all those other accessory pigments are variable amongst all of these oceans. They're physiologically adapting to the light and nutrient conditions that they have. And what they have at their disposal, one of the tools they have at their disposal, is how to synthesize those various pigments, how much chlorophyll. We're, as I said, chlorophyll is an imperfect proxy, because what we're saying is if I have a certain amount of chlorophyll, I have a certain amount of carbon. And that's a subject of lots and lots of papers, is the carbon to chlorophyll ratio. But again, you can imagine if I'm adjusting my chlorophyll for light conditions or even my accessory pigments, that might or might not have anything to do with how much carbon I'm synthesizing. So it's an imperfect proxy. We expect that. But we'd like to collapse this a little bit. And so what we noticed was, here's our current fluorometer. Again, we're looking at a spectrum here, so wavelength on the bottom. And in this case, we're looking at essentially concentration of pigments in a phytoplankton and in general. And so here's our chlorophyll curve that we saw before in the green. So it's absorbing in the violet and blue region. And here's our current LED. It's a 470 nanometer LED, which if you looked at it, is basically blue. So, and you're allowed to stare at that. Just be careful with an eco. If they do have a CDOM fluorometer in there, there's an ultraviolet LED, and you really don't want to look at that. So either tape it over or put your hand over it or put a pair of safety glasses on. But you can see that here's the green curve. We're in this region of the green curve. We're hitting a lot of these accessory pigments. And these are even more physiologically variable than chlorophyll is, because they're the ones that they have a lot of control over how they synthesize them. So we thought, what if we in addition, we put a more violet LED, and let's grab this region here of chlorophyll A, essentially target that pigment directly, its absorption, and we're also down much lower on the curve of at least a majority of these accessory pigments. So again, the idea is that, are we doing a better job at least exciting the chlorophyll pigments and getting a fluorescence response from them? And this is a hypothesis. It has to be proven by taking a lot of data, and we're just starting to do that. But what we've done in this case, here's the actual output of our current essentially blue LED, and here's the output of our new violet LED. And what we want to is deliver ECOs that have essentially two fluorometers. One, it's exciting chlorophyll with the purple LED, and the other with the blue. We're still capturing the fluorescence in the red. Chlorophyll fluoresces in the red. And we're just using, so we essentially have two chlorophyll fluorometers. We want to keep this one because this is where the global record is tied to, and it's the only way we can tell if we're doing better. So we don't want to deliver a fluorometer with just purple yet. Maybe in a decade, but for now, what we want is both of those. And they're now starting to be deployed on the Argo floats, which is the global array of biogeochemical floats. And so one question is, how do we guarantee that we get this color? There's some variability in the manufacturing process of LEDs. We can put a filter over it so that we guarantee that we pretty much have a nice purple LED. And so we did some tests in the Mediterranean. This is a little bit old data, it's all probably about a year and a half old, but basically we took one of the existing 470 nanometer blue LEDs, looked at this purple LED, and then we had our next generation instrument again with the 470. So we had two of those. And these black dots are that HPLC chlorophyll matchup. So first of all, we're doing really well matching up with the HPLC in this particular environment. So that's sort of luck, that doesn't always happen. But the other thing that we're seeing is all the fluorometers are reading the same thing. And you'd say, well, you haven't collapsed the variability. Well, we have no variability. We just looked at one site so far. And the point is to just deploy these globally and then start looking at those relationships between the different oceans and seeing if we can collapse that variability. And if we have less uncertainty in the chlorophyll concentration, maybe we'll have a little bit less uncertainty in the resulting biomass estimates, and that less uncertainty goes into our climate models and we get better predictions. So that's the approach. So in summary, we've been working closely with the Argo BGC community to essentially build what we call a better fluorometer. Developing these instruments takes time. We have to choose and improve the parts that we use. The way we calibrate these is exactly the same way we calibrate what we call the 470, the blue LED. And we've deployed these on Argo floats, and we are still looking for additional deployments, whether they're coastal or open ocean, where people can do these HPLC samples to help us essentially expand the global reach. So if you have an opportunity for that, let me know. We can talk afterwards, and we can provide you probably a demonstration instrument in return for what I know is both the lengthy and expensive process of getting these HPLC samples analyzed. So any questions so far on the ECO?
We have a question. Is there any research? On the research ships, we've used the wet star fluorometer historically as a flow through instrument.
Right.
These new optical systems, I guess they're more designed for like hole mounted or kind of like on the side of CCDs and sort of like a void space. Can they be used in a sort of chamber like system in a flow system?
Sure. So your question is about using, some people may not be familiar, the very first fluorometers that we made were flow through fluorometers. So there's actually a pipe or a tube that goes through. And surrounding that tube was a lamp, again, a 470 nanometer lamp, and then a photodiode, but it was a flow-through configuration as opposed to the ECO, which has a flat face, and you can imagine just sticking it in the water or it's on some platform somewhere. Yes, you can use ECOs in a flow-through configuration. We, in fact, have a standard design for a flow-through chamber. It's not perfect because it's made of plastic. That plastic is a little fluorescent, so there's a little bit of background. You can choose to enlarge it, but that's the way actually a lot of ships now are doing their flow through systems, is using the ECO. And so you can imagine just a cylinder with a nice cap with it's more sophisticated than this, but a couple of O-rings, and then you have an inflow port and an outflow port. In fact, our next generation internal calibration rig, as we call it, automated machine, uses exactly the same design. So we published the same design that we use in calibration. So you can at least feel confident that you're working on the same level that we do. And there are a number of ships that have done that. And for those of you who aren't aware of the ECO line is very flexible. Right. There are up to three ports. Some people will use several ECOs on their flow through systems, and they'll configure some of them just with different wavelengths of backscattering. It's one of the enigmas of ocean optics is what the true information you get out of spectral backscattering, but we know it has something to do with the structure of the cells and indexes of refraction and things like that. I refer you to the literature. It's like one of the grand challenges of ocean optics to make sense of that. But you could do that. So you could imagine a series of those chambers now, you know, in series, just like everything else in your flow through system. And that's how people have done up to 9 channels of backscattering, in addition to, let's say, a chlorophyll and CDOM fluorometer. So they might have up to 4 ECOs in line. Does that answer your question? So again, just to remember, we do release the design, or you can just purchase. We'll mill it for you, either way. So our next instrument that we're going to take a look at is the ACS. And I'm going to focus, go ahead.
Question on that.
Sure.
Is ambient light a problem if you have ambient light like varying with depth, like sunlight?
No, not really. The way the eco signal design works is it's never sampling. Well, the answer is possibly yes. Let me answer in two ways. The first is the electronics thing, is that we never have essentially the sensing element, in this case the photodiode on, without the LED on. So you're never just measuring ambient light. That said, if you take an ECO and you point it towards a source that has a high source of light in the region that the detector, and you put it in front of it, what can you do? So in general, pointing a sensor down in the ocean is better than pointing it up.
But do you see variability in a day?
No, not really. In general, ambient light isn't a problem by virtue, again, of the fact that we're only collecting signal when the LED is on. It's just so much brighter than the ambient light, even a few centimeters under the surface. So remember that red light from the sun, well, you may not know this, but water absorbs red light really well. So, and that's exactly the chlorophyll fluorescence region. So there just isn't much red light left coming back up, even after one or two centimeters in the ocean. So the water molecule itself is our friend with respect to reducing the ambient light in the ocean. For other wavelength pairs that might be more in the blue region, let's say CDOM, it could be a problem, but I've never seen a trace that's been corrupted with a down pointing sensor.
Wouldn't you think if you think of FRRF, that this strong light that is in the water already does something with the chlorophyll, and therefore your signal may be changed by the naturally occurring fluorescence?
Right, so I'll repeat his question. He mentioned a thing called an FRRF, which is a fast repetition rate fluorometer. And like any system, the photosynthetic system has kinetics, meaning there are processes that take time. The photon that goes into the reaction sensor starts off a chain reaction within the whole, if you've studied biology, Z scheme, but essentially it's a process that ultimately results in the synthesis of carbon, if you remember in the Calvin cycle, for those of you who took biology. The point is there's some time it takes for different things to happen, but there's also a certain capacity. You can, just like any system, you can fill it up. So the question has to do with, if we're flashing this light all the time, are we sort of preconditioning the chlorophyll molecule to sort of be filled up? And the answer is no. In general, we don't have a problem with that. It's not that bright. When you look at the fast repetition rate fluorometers, the ones that really do want to get in those kinetics, it's actually a very, very bright light. So they're flashing it, and then they're looking at essentially how the fluorescence changes in time, and that has something to do with the kinetics of that system, meaning how the time rate of change of that system. So it's a different problem. We used to sell a desktop-based fast repetition rate fluorometer that I think could be, some people plumbed in a flow-through configuration. We don't make one anymore. I think Chelsea Systems makes one, and there's a couple more out there, but they're it's sort of a deeper dive into the physiology of phytoplankton. But the basic question is, are we doing something that sort of biases our own experiment just by our sensing method? And the answer is no.
I didn't mean with the sensing method, but as you mentioned, if there's strong sunlight, then you may have preconditioned bias or something.
Well, that's a very good question, and that is true. We know that in the open ocean, in the sort of plus or minus the middle of the day, depends on where you are in the ocean and how bright the sun is. But yes, part of what happens is the phytoplankton themselves are flooded. Their system is essentially completely engaged with, there are more photons than they can use. They have mechanisms to take some of those photons and dissipate them in the heat. But one of the side effects is their fluorescence actually drops. And it has nothing to do with any change in chlorophyll. It doesn't have anything to do with any change in biomass. So if you looked at a fluorescence curve, let's say in the lit part of the ocean, you will see a daily cycle of fluorescence like this that has nothing to do with the fact of whether the diatoms are dividing or anything like that. So one answer is just don't measure during the day, do it at night, right? So, and that's actually very realistic. On the other hand, some of our floats, we have radiometers and we want them during the day. What's an optical oceanographer to do? We want light during the day and solar noon, but we've got the fluorescence. So that is a physiological process. So in fact, in the Argo float community, where we don't really have any control over the measurement, meaning the platform's deployed and it's gone for 4 years and we can't touch it again. So that's one of the values of having more parameters on a float. So we do use irradiance meters that actually measure the downwelling light. There are algorithms that estimate essentially the chlorophyll from different measurements of light. And we can use those together to back out essentially that fluorescence dip that has to do with the sun. There's some other techniques too. If you happen to have a mixed layer and you happen to have a backscattering meter, you can take a look at the fluorescence to backscattering ratio. And you'll see up here, if it's a mixed layer, you pretty much, like your coffee, you've mixed it up, it's all one color. So the particle concentration is theoretically uniform throughout that ocean mixed, vertical ocean mixed layer. Your backscattering signal should be roughly constant if it's mixed. Doesn't matter where in the coffee I put the sensor, it's all brown or milky brown. And it should be the same chlorophyll concentration, right? So if I move up into the lit zone and the fluorescence goes down, basically I take a deep fluorescence to backscattering ratio and put it up here and adjust. So now we're into a little bit of the voodoo of what we do in post-processing. It is a real phenomenon and we have to deal with it. And there's, other than doing it at night, that's the only perfect way to get around that problem.
Is that how the satellites do it at night, or?
Satellites just measure the light that's leaving the ocean. So part of that signal, in fact, you can see fluorescence from an ocean color satellite. So some of the satellites actually have a sensor, even if it's the Crayola six-pack satellite, have a sensor right at the chlorophyll fluorescence peak. And you can use what's called that fluorescence line height. And yes, if you did that, you would observe the same thing. Or if you made all of your chlorophyll measurements based on satellite fluorescence line height without correcting for that quenching of fluorescence, you would have a biased number, for sure. So you have to deal, it's just like one of those problems you have to deal with, and it's physiology, and not much we can do about that.
It might be a stupid question, but I don't know anything about this. What is the aim to measure the chlorophyll A and
Well, it's a proxy, which means it's a placeholder. We'd really like, at least nowadays, we'd like to know the carbon content of the ocean, right? So we'd like to know, that's the sort of what we're interested in, for example, is how the ocean sequesters carbon changing with climate change would be one question. before we were so interested in climate change, we just wanted to understand, well, how much, if I grow this much phytoplankton, how much actually sinks to the depth and becomes sequestered carbon, which in whatever, a million years or 2 million years becomes oil, right? That wasn't really the question, which was determine how much oil that we could make, because a million years seems to be too far in our time horizon. But we do care about how much is exported. In fact, that was the name of a recent, very well-known NASA field study. It was called Exports, to look at that exported carbon. Now, it just turns out it's pretty easy to sense chlorophyll. It's a lot harder to sense carbon. I mentioned the sea star is one way. When it kind of works for the global ocean, it's not clear that these relationships that we've developed for the global ocean apply to coastal areas. And it's really carbon that we're after, but we've picked a proxy that's easy, relatively easy to sense, even with all of the physiological variability, which is why there's uncertainty in those methods. When we look at the light coming from the ocean, we think maybe we can get different estimates based on the different colors of light, and the next generation satellites having more colors, a lot more colors, that we might be able to make a better estimate of carbon in the ocean than we can just from fluorometry. But we still want to ground truth it, right? So there's only so many places we can take a ship given a certain global budget, money budget. It's expensive to run a ship. It's expensive to take those samples. It's expensive to run them and do particulate organic carbon measurements. So what we'd like to do is establish these relationships between the proxies, like chlorophyll fluorescence, and chlorophyll, and then the next hop, carbon. And every time you take a hop, it gets a little trickier in terms of the uncertainty, but that's the game. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, on the global view, but we work mainly for the offshore wind sector, and we have been required to measure chlorophyll A and the parameters. So is there any other interest to measure chlorophyll A to know fish population?
I mean, if you think about it, essentially what we're trying to understand is how much food is available to the next trophic level or to the trophic web. And chlorophyll turns out to be a pretty good proxy for that. So if we're trying to understand, let's say, fishery status, if we know that chlorophyll is very low, it's going to support, you know, much more feeble or less productive ecosystem than others. So that's sort of a general thing, and probably works also in just regional or even local dynamics. The second thing is, if we have regions where we have harmful algal blooms, there are some more sophisticated methods to try to identify those specific species using color, but sometimes just knowing that there's a bloom is enough to be able to trigger understanding about a harmful algal, or at least alert about a harmful algal bloom. Typically, when you look at the monitoring systems for agriculture, they include multiple variables. They don't include just chlorophyll, and that's part of the leading edge of that science. Let's just talk about the ACS here. It measures absorption and it measures attenuation. So we have not only the lights, the photons that are absorbed in the absorption tube, but in the other one, the ones that get scattered too. And that's important. It's a relatively high sampling rate instrument, 4 Hertz. It's got the Crayola 80 pack of crayons, so it gives you lots of colors and it helps you start take a look at those curves. And here are some of the things that you can do, and we've talked a lot about these. Taking a look at phytoplankton functional groups, the example that we used was size fractions. We can take a look at what the essentially range of, or sort of how many small versus large that we have. We can take a look at the dissolved organic matter, all from that spectral information. And what we did is we changed from our yellow, essentially incandescent light, to a white light LED. And that did two things. It gave us a lot more output in this blue region below 525. And that I'll show you what the consequence of that is. But it also gave us a lot longer lifetime. We now have a 10,000 hour lifetime. If you want to take as one of our partners did, take a 187 day cruise and run it all the time, you can do that now. And they weren't able to do that before because the light would just burn out. And so that's less service cycles. And just to prove that, you know, we ran these things for almost 4,500 hours and extrapolated out the results, and we're confident in that 10,000 hour assessment of the LED. What we can see here is the direct effect. So here are the absorption curves from this instrument, where they're familiar now to us. They look a little bit like chlorophyll absorption curves, with a peak over here and a peak in the red. And we can see that before, we had a lot of uncertainty, which is what this is, the standard deviation of that. Those measurements were very high in the blue because the light was so weak. And basically the white LED gives us more blue, which means we have more confidence in this. And this is now starts to look like what we'd expect for the phytoplankton absorption or for the particulate absorption curve. So that's definitely an innovation that makes the instrument a lot more useful, especially if you're starting to do some of those spectral unmixing techniques. Getting it right in every part makes sense. And the final product that we're working on as part of this NASA PACE mission, which is called the Plankton Aerosol Cloud and Ocean Ecosystem, not experiment, it's a satellite. Again, the satellite has the Crayola about 244 pack of colors. It's the first essentially global satellite that will provide that kind of information. In this case, we would have essentially a drifting buoy that is just deployed from a ship, probably on a tether so that you can recover it, and it's just going to profile to probably not very deep and get the change in light with depth. And essentially you're just trying to estimate the color of the light that's leaving the water. There's also a chlorophyll fluorometer and backscattering meter, so we can get coincident measurements of those things. And those kind of programs typically take water samples too to get those matchups that I was talking about before with HPLC. This is all only available in the context right now of the NASA program. It's not a product yet, but it's available to the researchers that are part of this NASA satellite mission. I wanted to show you one thing. When you get to the Crayola sort of 280 or 500 pack, what you can start doing is this: we have modeled and measured. Modeled is essentially the modeled solar spectrum. We're just looking at the sun spectrum here that we did at the top of a mountain in Hawaii. What you start seeing are what are called Fraunhofer lines. These are distinct lines that don't vary in their wavelength at all because of the oxygen or water vapor in the atmosphere. So they act as actually wavelength reference points. It's like having built-in calibration. Your sun, you know, and the atmosphere doesn't change. So you always get these lines at these wavelengths, and that actually helps us do the calibration. But to an optical oceanographer, seeing this kind of detail is actually quite awesome. So you can actually see these little lines of absorption. And you can imagine if your bandwidth of your sensor is just a little bit wider, you miss those. So that's partly what you get, again, when you go to many, many more colors. So in summary, if we just go from one wavelength to two in a chlorophyll fluorometer, there's something we can learn and perhaps improve in terms of our estimates of chlorophyll and hence phytoplankton biomass. With the ACS white light, we're going to be able to enable new techniques like the spectral unmixing for particulate and dissolved ocean constituents, particle size information, biogeochemical information. We've improved its performance in the blue, and you can reliably deploy this instrument for longer periods, which allows you to do, you know, regional work more comprehensively. And finally, with HyperNav, our super duper hyperspectral radiometer, it's part of a natural evolution to more spectral information, initially in support of the NASA PACE satellite mission, and we're basically seeing the unseen, the previously unseen, like those Fraunhofer lines. So I went over, not too much. Any final questions that you have?
If the satellite data is like within a few percent of the ground truth data, is that why does that not necessitate as many of the like actual in situ measurements? I mean, like, why do we need so many in situ ones if you guys are doing like the HyperNav and prove that?
Right. So for example, if we calibrate a satellite and we only calibrate it at two points on the planet, we're subject to the biases of those two points on the planet. And I think one of those one points on the planet is going away, Boussole, which is the French one in the Mediterranean. And then you can imagine deploying these in different regions. And there's actually some innovative stuff that we're doing now with actually steering the floats. So we're essentially putting them in different regions of the vertical part of the ocean where we know the currents. We're able actually to pilot the vehicle, not like quite like a glider, but we can keep it from escaping, for example, which would be bad, because we want to recover these. They're expensive. But so there's some interesting side things that we're contributing to the Argo community about this. With respect to the validation work, that's a little different. There'll be a larger effort. There's a whole team, and we're part of one of the teams to essentially do the validation work. And again, multiple places all over the planet to do that. I'm at the Seabird booth. That's L9. If you have any other questions, you would like to follow up on any of the topics or instruments that we talked about, I'd be happy to talk with you. That's the best part of my job, is to talk to you about what your needs are or what your concerns are or the really great questions that came up here. These are all the right, you've asked all the right questions. Why chlorophyll? Doesn't the sunlight change our fluorescence measurement? These are all the things that we deal with. I can't say I know all the answers, but I can get you started and point you to people who do this work carefully. Thank you for coming. I'm really happy that we almost filled the room, and I appreciate your participation.